Hey, we're here.
Yep.
Hi, everyone. Just want to welcome you to the exam prep for the 70-410 installing and configuring Windows Server 2012. I have with me here today, what's your name again?
My name's Cynthia. I'm from JDATSG. I'm a Microsoft Certified Trainer as well as an Exchange PFE, and I'm here with Ed.
And I am Ed Lieberman. I'm with TrainSignal. I am the lead Windows Server instructor, and I'm just really excited to be here today to talk to you about the 70-410 exam. So what do you think? Should we go ahead and get started?
Yeah, we should just kick it off.
All right. Well, the first thing we'd like to go over with you is really what the process is all about when you want to go ahead and get certified. Okay, and we have kind of this four-step process here. We start off by identifying your certification goals, and we're gonna do that here today. We're gonna talk about the different certifications that are available to you. Once you have identified that goal and you figure out what exam it is that you're gonna go take, we have to find where there are gaps in your knowledge, right? That you have to go through and figure out, hey, I know a lot about Windows Server 2012, but there's still some components that maybe I'm a little shaky on. I don't do every day. Okay, so once we've identified those gaps, the next step would be to go ahead and fill those gaps. All right, so we're going to talk to you today about the different objectives that are going to be presented to you on this exam so that hopefully you can locate those exams. locate those gaps, and then go ahead and get the information you need and maybe practice a little bit more and fill those gaps. And then finally, once you've done all that, the last step, of course, is go out there and take the exam.
Yeah, just do it already.
Yeah, and you know, and it's funny, that might seem like an obvious step. You have to take the exam, but we'll talk to you in the end about how that's not an automatic. There is a process to getting ready in those final stages to taking the exam. And so we're gonna go ahead and wrap things up today with that part of the process. Right. So first thing, you know, we talked about identifying the different certifications. So if we can look at the different certifications that are available, you know, Microsoft has just revamped all of their certification program, and we have a nice triangle here, right? A nice pyramid.
Yes, a pyramid of focus here.
Yeah, so we're gonna start off down at the bottom, actually. We go from the bottom to the top. And at the bottom level, we have the Microsoft Certified Solutions Associate, or MCSA.
Which is what we're talking about here today.
Yes, we are gonna start off with the MCSA.
That's our foundation.
We're going to see in just a moment how the 410 exam does relate to that particular level of certification. But we do want to share with you that after you get your MCSA, you don't stop there. You may want to achieve higher level of certification. You may want to go on and become a solutions expert, which would be an MCSE. And really from there, if you have gone to become an expert, what's really next after you become an expert?
A guru, a master?
A master, great.
You think?
Hey, maybe we should put that in the suggestion box, the Microsoft Certified Guru. Master.
Guru, yeah.
Yeah, but anyway, no, we have the Microsoft Certified Solutions Master, so MCSM. And I will tell you, if we can look back at that pyramid for just a moment, there is one other level that I do want to mention to you, which is fairly new to a lot of people, which would, if anything, fall below the MCSA, which is the MTA, Microsoft Technology Associate. And this is something, if you know somebody who is just brand new to the IT industry and has never touched this stuff before and they're just getting started, that's a great way to get yourself rolling before you jump in and become an associate. All right, so, but let's talk about the MCSA. Let's talk about the associate certification. In order to become a, what was that little slip up there? In order to become a Microsoft Certified Solutions Associate, you have to take three exams. And there's one very specific thing I want to point out when looking at this particular diagram is there's three exams. There's the 410, 411, and 412. But I want to point out that typically we see arrows, whereas in this case we're seeing plus symbols. That's right. And what that means is you don't necessarily have to take them in that specific order. They don't have to progress, but
in combination,
most people do like to progress in that order. If nothing else, I love that the numbers are in order, nice easy to remember.
Nice easy to remember, yeah.
Now, on each of these exams, you'll notice that there are, and we have approximations here because these things do change over time, but what you want to get ready for on each of these exams is somewhere in the area of around 50 questions, And they'll give you around 2 to 3 hours. Mm-hmm. Okay, so we're going to address this a little bit more when we get to the end, when it comes to the specifics of the exam itself and kind of the mentality to put yourself in.
Right, to make sure you have enough time at the end to do all of the questions. And of course, it depends on which questions you're going to go through. And so we'll check that out.
Yeah, we'll take a look at all of that. Now, there is one other option if you are looking to become an MCSA, and if you are already an MCSA in Windows Server 2008, you are eligible to take a single upgrade exam. Okay, you can take the 417 exam, which takes pretty much the place of all three, 410,
yes.
11, and 12.
Think of it as three mini versions of 410, 411, and 412 combined into one, and that's your 417.
Yeah, and I will tell you there is one brief little plug that I'll throw in here.
Yes.
At the bottom
Please
of the
do.
Screen there, it was briefly showing the a link to the jumpstart that I recently did with Rick Claus. So if you are somebody who maybe does have experience with Windows Server 2008 and you are certified and you just want to upgrade, that's another resource that you can use. You can go to that jumpstart and we'll help get you ready for that upgrade exam. But let's reel it back in here and talk about this exam, which will be the 410 exam.
Yes, installing and configure Windows Server 2012.
Installing and configuring Windows Server 2012. All right, well, if you were to go out and look at all of the various objectives that are covered on this exam, you will see it's broken down into six sections. And unlike what we see on some of the other exams, where we'll have certain objectives or certain sections, certain areas, some people even call them the objective domains.
Right.
Some of them have some strong weight to them. Mm-hmm. Sometimes you'll see where on a certain exam, a certain section will have 30% of the exam, just on that one section. Whereas on this particular exam, because this is all about just installing and configuring, which means you kind of have to know how to install and configure every aspect
Everything.
Of Windows Server 2012, the objectives are all divided evenly on this particular exam. Okay, so what we're gonna do for the next 30 to 45 minutes is we're gonna go through each of the six objectives, or each of those six sections, and
pick a subtopic and talk about it a little bit so we have an idea of what's covered in that section. Obviously, we're not teaching everything because we're looking at 5 days worth of just Microsoft official training material. We cannot condense that into 60 minutes.
We can't?
No.
Are you sure?
I wish I could. That'd be great.
Man, could you imagine?
I will learn everything in 60 minutes in the Matrix style. Just upload it to my brain. Yeah.
Awesome. So, yeah. So that is a very important point to make sure that you understand is there's no way we can take you from, 0% ready to 100% ready in the next hour. But if on the assumption that maybe you've been playing with this for a while, we can get you, maybe from 80 or 90% ready to very close to that 100% ready to go out there and take the exam.
And don't be surprised if you're just starting to doing the certification. It's very normal to not feel 100% ready when you go into the exam. But as long as you're following the steps, planned steps of studying, even if you feel I'm not quite 100%, go take the exam anyways. Once you step across that threshold of taking your first exam, it feels better. It does feel better. And then you will have a flow going and then ready to go. So,
awesome. Well, let's go ahead and jump into our first objective. Mm-hmm. And this first objective, I'll tell you, is it's interesting because the name of the exam is installing and configuring, and the name of this first objective is install and configure servers.
Right. Which, you think
again,
that's all of the exam, but
yeah,
no.
Isn't that the entire exam, install and configure?
Yeah, wait.
Well, it's just 1/6 of the exam, which is on the installation and configuration of the server itself, as opposed to installing and configuring everything else. Okay, so when it comes to installing and configuring the servers themselves, let's see, first of all, before we install anything, Cynthia, what do we have to do? We have to plan, right? We have to plan the installation of those servers, all right?
Because you mean I can't just go and install whatever I want and follow default?
Well, you could.
Next. No?
Well, that's all there is to it, right?
Yeah.
I'm going to go take the test right now.
Yeah.
All right, so here's the thing. You know, there's a kind of a saying out there, and that's if you fail to plan, then what do?
I guess you plan to fail.
Yeah, then you plan to fail. All right, so that's something to always keep in mind. Now, once you've planned out where your server's gonna go, and I should point out, in this particular exam, the scope really isn't heavily focused on that planning. It's something that I'm always heavily focused on because if you're out there working on an enterprise, you have to always plan everything. But on the exam itself, it's not a huge part of the scope. Yeah. We'll get into that when we get into the later exams, especially when we get into the expert level exams. Now, the actual installation of the server itself, I mean, Cynthia, you mentioned it a moment ago. Yeah, to some extent, I mean, Microsoft has really made things easy with the whole next finish, right? And there are a few things that you have to know along the way. But I'm also going to assume that at this point, you have installed Windows Server 2012. Beyond that, you have to look at some of the specifics. You have to look at the different versions and figure out, you know, make sure you're running the right version to fit your needs. You have to make sure that you decide whether you want to install the full GUI or whether you want to install the Server Core Edition. And this is something that's real key right now with Windows Server 2012 in that the default setting, if you do just click next, is you're going to get Server Core. And that's something that, although we had in Windows Server 2008, it's really becoming popular now in Windows Server 2012. Because you want to keep in mind that Windows Server 2012 was built for what, Cynthia? What's that buzzword right now?
Cloud.
The cloud, right?
Which means everything's in the cloud. You're not sitting in front of the server interactively touching the keyboard anymore, or at least you shouldn't be doing that anymore. So you have a much better, more streamlined installation of the server.
Yep. And actually, that, you know, when we say it's in the cloud, we're talking about virtualized servers. We're talking about remote servers,
yes,
you know, out in the cloud, out in a remote mm-hmm. data center somewhere. And because that's how we expect the majority of our servers to be, well, it's assumed you're going to work with Server Core. Mm-hmm. Now, even though that might be the default setting, I will tell you that for me personally, I always install, at least if it's the first of a given type of server, if it's going to be a replica, that's fine. Just replicate it, boom, Server Core. But the first one, you want to install with the full GUI. And here's a real key feature of Windows Server 2012, is that you can now switch back and forth between the full GUI and Server Core, or from Server Core back over to the full GUI. So I like that we can have the full GUI, which means it allows me to sit down and touch the keyboard and touch the mouse and have all the interface that I'm used to, get everything set up the way I want it, and then strip out all the unneeded, wasted resources and make it Server Core. Mm-hmm.
And one thing I do want to mention is because jokingly we say we can just press next and get the server installed, it is a good practice to look through the installation wizard. There's more and more information added into these graphic interface wizards. And just read through it, see what your options are. And for the purpose of the exam also is you set yourself up for some extra knowledge that you can take in about the installation process. So you know what to expect, even some suggestion on how to do certain tasks with PowerShell. It's also written as part of the graphic interface.
Yeah. Well, and that's actually another interesting point is PowerShell in itself. Mm-hmm. I will tell you that objectives or no objectives, you know, you can go and you can look at the list of objectives. I will tell you PowerShell is another major component of Windows Server 2012. It's another major component of the questions that you could get on the certification exam. Mm-hmm. And the reason is because everything was built off of PowerShell, which is actually a plus. I know some people look at it as, well, why? Why do we want everything from this command line? Why can't we have the mouse? Why don't we point and click? Well, you can. The difference is, whereas in the old days, you could only do certain things from one arena or the other. Now, everything that you can do through the GUI, you can also do from the PowerShell command prompt. And it's because the GUI was built off of that PowerShell. So, what else do we have in this section? Besides installing the servers themselves, we have configuring the servers. Okay, so, you know, installing is next. When it comes to configuring, another key component to Windows Server 2012, and that is the newly redesigned Server Manager.
Aha! The beautiful tool that you can do just about everything in.
Just about?
Just about.
Will it wash your clothes for you?
No, it will not julienne fries, sorry.
Okay, so at least we understand why it's just about,
because
it really is just about. I mean, it does everything but that. So the really cool thing about configuring the servers through Server Manager now and managing your servers through Server Manager is that the newly designed Server Manager works the exact same way whether you're sitting locally at the machine, I'm right here at the machine, I'm working on this machine here, or if I'm sitting back relaxing at my desk on my Windows 8 client with the remote server manager, it's the exact same tool. Whereas, again, if we go to previous versions of Windows Server, you couldn't do the same things depending on whether you were local or remote. Now you can do the same thing no matter where you are. And not only that, but it gives you the ability to manage more than one server at a time. Not just because you can sit at your own local machine and connect remotely to all the different servers, but right in that one tool, you can actually group the servers together and then perform functions to all those servers at the same time. So,
yeah, perfect.
Now, the last piece of this particular objective is storage, right? Configuring your local storage. And when it comes to local storage, there's actually a lot you need to pay attention to. And for anybody who has worked with server before, you'll know that you'll notice that things haven't changed a lot. But so you need to make sure that you do focus on the basics. And we're going to talk about that in a few different arenas where we need to make sure that we stay with the basics that we've used over the years going all the way back. When it comes to local storage, you have to understand that you have your disks.
Yeah. Don't neglect the basics.
No, never neglect those basics.
Yeah.
But you have those disks. And on those disks, you then have the partitioning or the separation into different logical storage units on those disks. And you need to be familiar with the different ways of doing that in today's operating environment. So we have our basic disks versus our dynamic disks. This is something that's been around since Windows 2000. We need to make sure that we know the difference between a disk that uses a master boot record versus a GPT.
It just sounds cool.
Yeah.
It's a great acronym.
It actually does stand for something. It's GUID partition table.
Yes.
GPT sounds so much better.
Yeah.
So yeah, you do need to know the difference between your MBR and your GPT. Mm-hmm. Okay, you have to know the difference between where and what type of disk you can extend and shrink your partitions or volumes. Mm-hmm. Okay, and that's another one, the terms between partition and volume.
Yes.
Okay, partition is kind of an old school term. When we go back to our old basic disks, the same ones we used back in the days of DOS. Whereas in today's world, with our newer, you know, GPT-based disks, we're talking about volumes. And then, of course, we always have RAID. And even though, again, in many real-world scenarios, we may use hardware RAID, on the certification exam, we need to make sure that we also are familiar with the software version of RAID that is built into the Windows Server operating system.
That's right.
And I will tell you that even though it's real quick and easy and everyone will pretty much acknowledge the benefits that you get from the hardware RAID, the reality is that I've used Microsoft software RAID in a number of environments, and it does come in quite handy to implement, especially when you don't have the means, you know, the money or the time to run out and go get that hardware RAID controller. So you want to make sure you're familiar with that.
Yeah, or if you just don't have the resources to set it all up, because setting up a hardware RAID does take time, there's planning as well. So with the software RAID, you are already familiar with the tools, the graphic interface tools to configure them. So having multiple disks with your server, it's much easier to set up. So you have a little bit of a RAID protection ahead of time without having to go full on hardware RAID.
Absolutely. And matter of fact, you just hit upon something as far as the different hardware and having the different hardware available is there's a new type of storage, and it's not brand new. It's not like suddenly now in 2012 we've just invented this. We've had it, but it's just becoming much more prominent now, and that is the virtual storage.
Yes.
Okay, having your virtual hard disks for your virtual machines. And we'll talk about Hyper-V and virtualization because that is one of the objectives.
Of the
yep. We're going to talk about that in just a couple minutes. But you do need to be familiar with that type of storage as well.
Yeah.
All right. Great. Well, let's move along to the next objective and talk about it. Go ahead.
Roles and features.
What's the difference between a role and a feature?
It's just not just a separate section within the server manager when you're installing additional components, where you go to features or where you go to roles. But understanding that role is really designating what your server does. It's the function of your server, whereas features are the add-ons, additional things that you can do with your servers. So deciding between the two, and really look through the list of your options. That explains quite well what is a feature and what is a role. For example, DNS is a role. So
DHCP?
DHCP,
Active Directory.
If you still use Wins.
Ah, is Wins a role? A trick question.
Yeah, that's right.
It's not. It's a feature. Yeah. So Wins is now a feature.
Yeah, it's been
so, a feature. Another thing about the roles and features, again, is really when it comes down to configuring and installing them, it is done with the server manager, the newly designed server manager. So what does that mean? Awesome. It means you can install it remotely, and you can install it on multiple servers at the same time. That's Make sure that you are familiar with doing this if you've never done that before. Yeah. Okay, sit down, work with this product. That is definitely one of the objectives on the exam.
Yes, that's a very good point, is if you've used the, or if you're familiar with the interface, it makes the exam taking process a lot easier, because certain questions, and when you get asked, you just go back to visualizing that dialogue box in your mind, and you can pretty much decide which option you're supposed to go with. If you can see it in your head, you know the answer to it.
Yeah, and I will tell you, there is another really cool thing that I like about, and this is true since Windows Server 2008, so if you've worked with that, you are familiar with this already, but that is that when installing certain roles or features, if there are supporting roles or features that need to go along with it. You know, back in the old days, if you would install a role and it required some other component, you would just get an error message saying, you have to go install that other component first. Now, you get a dialogue saying, hey, you need these other components. Do you want to install them also? And I love it, because for me personally, and Cynthia, I don't know if you've had any different experience, but I have never, and I mean never, and it's rare that I say never, but I've never had it fail on me. Like, I've never had it not do the correct add-ons. It just, it just doesn't.
Yeah. And in old days, you kind of have to memorize what the prerequisites are before you install any of those additional components. And at the moment, during regular work process, because the wizard will go ahead and install requirements for you, you don't really need to think about them as much. But for the purpose of the exam, when you're doing the installation, read your screen so you know what the prerequisite components are, so you can be more confident in answering some of these questions.
Absolutely. Now, if we get into kind of the sub objectives that fall under the configuring of roles and features, one of the things that we need to make sure we're familiar with is things like file and shares.
Yes. Okay?
And again, you know,
it seems like an easy thing, but really, it can get tricky.
It can. It can. Yeah. And again, we were just talking about this when it came to storage. I'm going to say the exact same thing. As a matter of fact, I'm going to emphasize it even further when it comes down to things like NTFS permissions and shared permissions. You have to go back to the basics. These things haven't really changed. I mean, I'll tell you that when I'm in the classroom and I am teaching NTFS permissions today, I'm essentially teaching the exact same thing that I was teaching back in 1998.
Yes.
Okay, I mean, it has not changed. Now, there is one small change, and I'll mention it to you in just a moment, but it really, from a concept standpoint, it's the same. In other words, knowing that you have your users and you have your groups, and the users are members of groups, and you know, based upon the different groups that have been allocated different levels of permissions, you might have a single user who, on one hand, should only have read-only access to a file or folder, and on the other hand, they have full control access to that file or folder. And you need to know, okay, well, wait, if I'm a member of these two groups, What do I actually have?
Yeah, which one wins?
Yeah, and so as much as we could easily talk for an hour or two on just this one thing, which we don't have that time to do it, I do want to make sure that you do understand the absolute basics of when it comes to NTFS permissions and combining them. Mm-hmm. It's always the least restrictive. Okay, so in that example where you have read-only over here and you have full control over here, it's the least restrictive, which means you end up with full control. Yeah. Whereas on the share permission side of things, it's the exact same rules. If I'm a member of two different groups that have shared permissions, and one of them is read-only and one of them is full control, I end up with full control. Where it gets complicated is when you bring the two together.
Combine the two, yes.
Right? Yeah. When I now am connecting remotely via a share, and there are share permissions and there are NTFS permissions, you need to figure out the ultimate NTFS permission and the ultimate share permission, but then between these two, I feel like I'm going to box with,
you're gonna
they're
going to
box
up
with each other. Yeah. Between these
Duke
two,
it
it's now the more restrictive of the two. So if the end result share permission was full control, but the end result NTFS permission was read-only, now you end up with read only. Okay? And I don't want to go any deeper because I open, you know, a big can of worms and might confuse people. So what I did promise, though, is there is one new feature to NTFS permissions, and that is that we now have conditions, and this is brand new. And something that, quite frankly, you know, I know we've talked about it since I first got in this business back in the 90s. Okay, we talked about the idea of why does this all have to be so restricted to just users and groups and nothing else. Well, now we get much more flexible in the fact that we have these different conditions that can be established to determine whether a permission is going to apply. And then we also have our friend Abe.
Abe,
which is access-based enumeration. And we're not going to go into great detail of that here, but it is something that you're going to want to go into great detail about when you're playing with it and learning about it.
Yes.
Because it has to do with something that comes up actually in a later exam, and it's something called dynamic access control. Okay, and so it's, you know, a lot of people are looking at this as a replacement, or you know, instead of NTFS permissions, and it's really, it's not a replacement, it's an add-on. And it's a great way of making it that when somebody should be seeing something or should have access to it, they can see it. And when they don't have access to it, they don't even see it. And that's a great feature to make it that when somebody doesn't have access, they don't even see it. Because what happens when they see it? Well, then they start messing with it, right?
Yep. So if they don't know, they won't miss it.
Yes. So, if they don't know it's there, they won't know to mess with it. So that's good. As an IT administrator, you definitely like that. So another sub topic that we have here, and this is a real basic one, and I tell you, a lot of people just kind of laugh at this one because they think, what's the big deal? It's printing, right? It's configuring print services. It's just printing. I hit print and a piece of paper spits out. Well, you're going to have to know a little bit about printing. Okay? You're going to have to understand, and this is always a fun one going back through the years, is the difference between a printer and a print device. Now the good news is
here we go.
I haven't seen them getting too tricky on the test questions with this as much as they used to. But in case you see something, or even if you're just reading documentation, you want to know the difference.
During your study up time.
Yeah, difference between a printer and a print. Yes, when studying. That is a huge one.
When studying, because it gets confusing because you're calling this piece of metal and plastic that spits out paper printer, and then you call the same little icon on your desktop printer. But so during study time, just realizing that when the documentation says print device, that's the hunk of plastic and metal they're talking about. And printer is the software that you configure, you set permissions, you set drivers, that's your printer.
Yeah, yeah. And I will tell you, when it comes to printing, although Microsoft has made slight advancements, but they are slight because really, you know, if it ain't broke, don't fix it, right? I mean, printing works quite well.
Yeah.
We still have things like printer priorities and printer pooling. Matter of fact, when it comes to printer pooling, there is something that is new, and that is the support for the V4 printer drivers. Okay, so we have V3 and V4 printer drivers. And the idea behind the V4, or I guess version 4 printer drivers, is that you now have a little bit more flexibility. Matter of fact, you have a lot more flexibility when it comes to one driver for multiple print devices, okay, whereas in the past
it was... not need to be the same.
Yeah, no, in the past you had to have a separate driver for every single print device make and model that was out there.
Yeah.
Now we can group some of them together.
Much easier.
Yeah, the other thing is the installing of the driver itself, right? Mm-hmm. Because you can install the driver by using Windows Update or a WSUS server. Okay, that's redundant, I think, WSUS server, since the S is server.
S is already in there.
Yeah. So that's something to keep in mind, is look into, if you've never heard of that before, because that is one of those small little tidbits of information that people will just kind of pass by.
Yeah.
Make sure that you look up that whole V3 versus V4 drivers when it comes to printing.
Yeah, and then when you see it in the options, just be aware that these terminologies, they are real things. They weren't just makeup terminologies to confuse you. So when you're confident in which terminology you should be using, it won't easily sway you into non-existent objects.
See, I actually like doing that.
I just like to throw people off.
I like makeup terminology just to throw people off. So anyway,
make up a new acronym and see what happens and see if people will sway to the question.
There is one more subtopic here, and it is something that we've already pretty much been talking about, and that is getting ready for remote management. Mm-hmm. That's right.
Yeah.
So not to beat a dead horse, but really, what does it come down to? It comes down to the new server manager is completely set up for simple Windows remote management, being able to sit on your Windows 8 client or another server and manage all your servers.
Do not have to be in the data center to manage your servers, and that's
like
a big
data
difference.
Center.
Nice and chill, especially when there's a heat wave. Just hide in there. Yeah.
Go find a server room.
Yeah, that's right.
All right, so should we move along, or is there something you want to add there?
I want to add one more thing also, is that during the exam process, some of these questions may seem easy, but when you read through the questions, if you cannot visualize it, it's harder to answer those questions. So earlier when we talked about the NTFS and shared permissions, and I like your gestures, you're duking it out.
Yeah, yeah.
But really, the exam centers will provide you with pieces of paper, scrap paper, and pen. Just draw them out. Draw a little table for yourself. Here is all the group membership that this particular user had. List what the question says that the permissions they have. Separate column, shared permissions. And you take, compare the two, and then you finally arrive at the conclusion for that. The other thing that you need to pay attention to is, along with the permissions, just remember what happens to these permissions when you copy or move folders. That does tend to throw people off. And again, don't forget the basics. These basics hasn't changed, but it does confuse people when you're in an exam situation. If you're nervous, that could throw you off.
Nervous.
So use those scrap paper.
We don't need to be nervous because we're going to prepare.
I'm jumping
to the end of our session here. We'll talk about getting prepared, so you don't have to be nervous in the exam. But
as much preparation as you have, you feel better about it.
Yeah, and the one key to keep in mind when it comes to moving your files and folders around and how permissions might change is that inheritance is a huge role.
Yes.
And again, inheritance is not new. Mm-hmm. It really hasn't changed. But it's one of those basics you need to make sure you're familiar with, or else you're going to go astray on this information.
Yeah. And you end up losing points on so-called easy questions. Why would you want to do
they're
that,
all easy
right?
questions.
Yeah, they're all easy questions.
All right, so. Mm-hmm.
Let's talk about the next topic.
Yeah.
Hyper-V. It's a really cool
three,
one.
Hyper-V.
Yes.
You know, this is a big one, right? This is a big one, not necessarily for this exam. It's a big one in Windows Server 2012.
Yes, the improvements, the tools, the interface. Makes everything better.
Yes, and I just mentioned a moment ago that it's new. Mm-hmm. Hyper-V is not new. Hyper-V has been around for a while. There's a new version of Hyper-V, and it is a new and much, much better version than anything we've seen, possibly across the board with virtualization, whether it be Hyper-V or whether it be some of the other virtualization technologies that are out there. Okay, so when it comes to Hyper-V. You know, this is one of those there's a lot, so it's really difficult for us to take a few minutes and tell you, well, here's a few key things to know about Hyper-V. I mean, whether it's your virtual machines themselves or your virtual switches, which maybe that's one key, is because they've switched the name.
Terminology change.
Yeah, it used to be virtual networks, now it's virtual switches, your virtual hard drives, your VHDs.
And VHDX.
And VHDX, right. So there's a lot that you really need to know. And if you are not used to virtualization, okay, if this is not something you've been playing with, and I can relate with you, okay? So if you're kind of old school like I am, you like to sit at an actual machine, you like to touch the actual machine, well, guess what? We, you and me, we need to get used to the idea that that's not where we're at anymore, okay? That is a huge waste of resources. It always has been. It's just that we now have the ability to have these virtual machines that will act just like the real machines. Mm-hmm. And maybe some of those little quirks, those little bugs that we had in the past, well, those are gone now. Mm-hmm. Okay, and it works now. And I've had to get used to it, and I have to tell you, I'm really actually excited about it now.
Right.
So as much as I sit here and I talk about how, you know, if I'm kind of old school, I'm very quickly becoming new school when it comes to virtualization.
Especially when it works.
Well, it definitely
when
works.
When it works great, when it solves the issue of wasted resources, you can dynamically scale that, that's beautiful.
Yeah, so, Hyper-V is something that if you haven't touched it, please, please, please stop working with physical machines, install Hyper-V, put on those virtual machines, and you're ready to rock and roll. And here's kind of the win-win with this. The win-win with this is that if you're prepping for certification exams,
you're probably using a virtual machine to test it.
Yeah, you need to touch everything.
Yes.
And in order to touch everything, you got to have more than one computer, right? Because these are networking operating systems, right? They need to have computers talking to each other. And if you don't want to have a room full of computers, or maybe you can't afford a room full of computers, one computer as long as you have enough resources, right? Make sure you have enough processing power and memory, hard disk space. Mm-hmm. I suppose technically we go to the fourth area of memory, which is mm-hmm. which is the networking itself, mm-hmm. but that's only going to matter if you're communicating outside of that box. Mm-hmm. Well, you use that one box and now can create the simulated enterprise and play with everything. So, you know, mm-hmm. make sure that you go ahead and do that. And it's kind of a win-win. You get to learn Hyper-V mm-hmm. and you get to learn Windows Server 2012 right. and everything else that we're talking about here today.
Yep. During study time and for the purpose of the exam, you do want to get used to the graphic interface, understanding that when you configure or making changes to a setting, how that affects your individual virtual machines, how they interact with each other. So if you are studying through maybe Microsoft official curriculum, all of your labs are using Hyper-V. So you're getting used to that network already. If you're studying through things like maybe the Virtual Academy, you have the ability to see the graphic interface as well. So I constantly want to emphasize and just let people know that really pay attention to the graphic interface. Understand what your options are.
Absolutely. All right. So as much as we just said Hyper-V is a major thing, we're going to move along and we're going to get into the next objective.
Yes. Well, because in exam 410, it's about installation. So mm-hmm. the detailed configuration and the impact of certain settings, that comes along to the next exams.
Yeah. And that is definitely something to keep in mind. As a matter of fact, you know, if we can kind of take a quick side note for just mm-hmm. a moment here, something I do want to mention when it comes to taking these certification exams, and that is, I mentioned how we have the 410, 11, and 12 to become mm-hmm. an MCSA.
Yeah.
It is the kind of thing where they should really be preparing for all three
together
before they even go to take the
yes.
one. Okay? So as much as we're talking about installing and configuring here, whereas in 411 we'll talk about administering, and in 412 we'll talk about advanced services, it's really helpful mm-hmm. to know all of these.
Yes.
Before you go take any one of these, because there's a lot of overlap mm-hmm. in these exams.
Yes.
Okay, so that's where when you mention Hyper-V and the real detailed information is going to come later on, mm-hmm. that's where it's going to be. So anyway, moving along into the next objective
network
here.
Network services.
Yeah, network, core network
core
services.
Core network services, the installations.
Yes, and that is that is something really good to know, is that it's called the core network services, meaning we want to make sure that we understand the basics of working with these networking services, whether mm-hmm. it be, I got a frog in my throat there for a minute, but whether it be IP, just IP subnetting, right? That's mm-hmm. how people used to think of it, as IP subnetting. Now we have IPv4, which was
IPv6.
Yeah, the traditional subnetting, mm-hmm. and then with IPv6.
That changes the ball game completely.
Yeah, do you use IPv6?
No, for it.
I heard IPv6 isn't going to be around for another 10, 20 years.
It'll never happen in this,
right? No, it'll never happen. But guess what? It's here.
It's here. Now, it's been here for a while.
Yeah. But I mean, now it's here and it's being used. Now, is it the prominent IP services? No. I think IPv4 is still what you're going to find used more often than IPv6. But the difference is now IPv6 is being used, mm-hmm. whereas before it was, you had that one occasional person who just has to be on the cutting edge of everything, and mm-hmm. even without knowing what IPv6 really was, said, let's implement it. No, it's here, and it's being used, and there are certain features and functions in Windows Server 2012 which either require IPv6 or, more often than not, just function better with IPv6. Mm-hmm. Okay, so that is something to keep in mind. But again, back to the basics, mm-hmm. if we go back to IPv4, you have to know how to subnet. And I know no one likes to hear that because it's math. And it's that one subject. I know we're all computer geeks, so we're all supposed to be good at math. I can tell you what, even as computer geeks, when I'm in the classroom and I say, who here's good at math? Raise your hand. It's only half the class. Math is a subject.
You get half? Wow.
Yeah, well, sometimes.
But, lucky.
No, math is still one of those topics that people just, you know, they kind of struggle with. So
instant mental block.
Yeah.
It's really not that difficult. It's binary. It's zero and ones, but instant mental block.
It's easier, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
Isn't
zero
and ones easier
be.
Than 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9?
Yeah.
So much more. But it's just, you know, that's how we're typically brought up. Mm-hmm. So you're going to want to know the binary math. You're going to want to study that. You're going to want to know subnetting. Mm-hmm. There's all sorts of different tips and tricks out there. Every book I read, every instructor I talk to has a different way of presenting it. And they're all wonderful. They really, really are. Matter of fact, my own TCP/IP lessons have migrated dramatically over the years, even though it's the exact same thing. Mm-hmm. It's just every time I hear another cool way of presenting it, I like to use it. So keep in mind that you're going to have to find a way for you to understand it. And, you know, there was a tip that you just threw out there, Cynthia, mm-hmm. about the when you go into the test center, how they give you scratch paper, or sometimes mm-hmm. they'll give you like a dry, you know, a little
dry erase board. Yeah. I don't like those.
I don't personally think memorization is the best way to learn something, mm-hmm. but I do know there's a lot of people out there who they struggle with the math itself, so they go ahead and they memorize certain binary tables. Mm-hmm. If that's you, that's okay, right? I don't hate you for it. But when you get in the test center, you get in the test room, really, I should say, mm-hmm. the very first thing you do, start jotting that down, okay? Because mm-hmm. you can't bring it in with you, but you can jot it down once you get in. Well, it's fresh on
your mind. Bring in your head.
Yes, yes. So you're going to want to make sure you know that. Now, when it comes to IPv6, you're going to want to understand the basic makeup of IPv6. That's one of the main, there's probably two main components to IPv6 in this particular exam, okay? So if we stay in the context of this exam, you're gonna wanna know how IPv6 addresses are made up.
Mm-hmm. You know, as how far it looks different from IPv4. You'd be able to answer a question such as, you know, pick out the address that's IPv6.
Yep.
So with your option, and this sounds simple, but if you've never seen an IPv6 address, if you never understood how you shorten those addresses, how to get rid of those extra zeros, that might throw you off. So for the context of 410 exam, understand the difference between an IPv4 address and IPv6 address, and understand what are the supporting features. You know, IPv4, we had to understand subnet, subnet mask, and configuration. So make sure that's part of something that you can instantly recognize without spending too much time on that type of question.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. And, you know, and speaking of truncating all the zeros, mm-hmm. you know, part of the reason why is because we are looking now at a 128-bit
address. Yeah.
Not 32
That'll take
anymore.
A while to write it out.
Yeah, so that's something to keep in mind. But there's a second component here that we need to make sure we know, and that is when we are going to have functionality between IPv4 and IPv6, right?
Yes.
Because pretty much almost every
network out
there,
they have to play nice together.
Yeah, they all still have mm-hmm. IPv4.
Yeah.
So if you're going to bring in IPv6, it's very rare that you're just going to completely throw IPv4 in the garbage and then start over with IPv6. Yeah. And so outside of that one scenario, they have to play friendly. Mm-hmm. Okay, so you're going to want to know certain technologies like Teredo.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and understand.
ISOTAP.
Yeah, ISOTAP. Mm-hmm. Make sure you know how to implement them. And there are others out there, and that's another feature to Windows Server 2012 is mm-hmm. When it comes to the support of IPv6 is that we now have a number of different migration technologies and intermingling technologies that work together.
Yes.
So that is something to definitely keep attention to. Mm-hmm. Now, if we move past the TCP/IP stuff, well, really the IP part of TCP/IP.
The IP part of it, yeah.
We also have things like DHCP, mm-hmm. the Dynamic Host Configuration Protocol.
DORA!
DORA!
Dora.
Dora. My kids watch some
little
show, right?
The Discover, the Offering, the
Request.
Oh,
you're talking about that Dora. Okay.
That Dora,
not,
yes.
Not Dora the Explorer. Okay.
Maybe Dora the Explorer can teach you how TCP, DHCP works. That'd be
in
awesome.
Spanish.
In Spanish.
Now that would be cool.
That'd be tricky.
Okay. So anyway, yes, no. When it comes to DHCP, I will tell you this. In the context of this exam, it's the basics.
Yes.
And those basics have not changed mm-hmm. in the sense that DHCP, that's not a Microsoft-specific technology. That is that's a networking standard.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so yes, you need to know the interface. You have to know how it works in Microsoft operating environments.
Yeah.
But DHCP is DHCP. Mm-hmm. You have to, again, go back to the basics. You have to know how it works. But there are a couple of new features mm-hmm. of DHCP in Windows Server 2008. Mm-hmm. Like DHCP failover, and support for IPv6. Mm-hmm. Okay, so these are other things that, although they are outside the scope of the 410 exam, they will fall more into like the 412 exam, which mm-hmm. which we'll talk about in another session. It's good to know them so that when you're reading through a test question, that may be mentioned. You may have that verbiage brought up, mm-hmm. even though the question may not be on that verbiage. They may be part of the scenario that's being drawn out for you in the question. So you're going to want to be familiar with those new features as well.
Right. Yeah, so understand how to install your DHCP mm-hmm. In your Windows
it's
Server
a role.
2020. It's a role. You got to follow the rules here, too. And understand the configuration, knowing what a scope is, knowing how to set up scope options. Those are part of the installation of DHCP.
Yeah, and that is another key thing is the scope options in the mm-hmm. sense that DHCP is not just about handing out IP addresses.
Mm-hmm.
It's about handing out an entire TCP/IP configuration. Let a client know what their IP address is, know what I almost said DHCP server. That is something they do get, but you don't configure that. It happens automatically. But their DNS server, their WIN server, if you're still using that, their default gateway, and so on and so forth. But there's another networking technology, and it's a core networking technology we need to make sure we understand, and that is DNS. Another one that is not, you know, Microsoft specific. It's not new. It's an industry standard, but you need to be familiar with the domain naming system, which is DNS, which, and I, you know, again, I assume you should know it at this point, but it's the idea, the general idea of DNS, especially in the context of this exam, is being able to resolve names to IP addresses. Mm-hmm. Okay, I always refer to us as stupid humans, and here's the thing.
You mean before, we don't memorize numbers? Come on.
You know, before anybody gets offended, you know, and like, did he just call me a stupid human? I'm calling myself a stupid human, and what I mean by that is when I want to go to a website, for instance. Okay, I'm out on the internet. I want to go to a website. I don't memorize the IP address. I can't memorize those numbers. If I want to go to Microsoft.com, I haven't a clue what numbers are going to get me there. Not only that, but there's more than one set of numbers, yes, more than one IP address that gets you to the Microsoft.com web server. So we need to be able to remember the name, Microsoft.com. Mm-hmm. DNS is what's going to allow that to happen. Mm-hmm. You need to make sure you understand how to install DNS. Again, it's a role.
It's a role.
Mm-hmm. You need to make sure you understand how to implement and configure that DNS to go ahead and resolve those names for you.
Yeah, understand what a DNS zone is, how to create a new zone, understand what an individual host record is, what's the difference between forward lookup and reverse lookup, and what a pointer record is, and be able to tell host records from maybe an IPv4 address and an IPv6 address. So that's all part of this DNS component that you need to know for the 410 exam itself.
Yeah, yeah. And you just mentioned as far as some of the records and IPv4 and IPv6, mm-hmm. One very specific thing to remember is that IPv4 has something called A records. Mm-hmm. Okay, and this is your typical just name lookup record, right? Yep. When I say Microsoft.com, what IP address mm-hmm. is it? With IPv6, it's a, when some people say AAAA record, and some people say it's
quad
a 4A
a.
or mm-hmm. a quad A record. Mm-hmm. Okay, and by the way, one way to remember this and why it's a quad A or mm-hmm. 4A or whatever is that an IPv4 address is a 32-bit address. An IPv6 address
is four times that.
It's 128 bits. That's right. The other thing about DNS, just to keep in mind, mm-hmm. is that it serves another huge function in Windows Server environments, and that is to provide something called SRV resource records mm-hmm. to work or allow Active Directory to have full functionality on your network. Yep. And you know, speaking of Active Directory, If we jump into our next objective.
Yeah, what the next topic is.
Nice segue there. Yeah, all right. Yes, the next objective, and I will tell you, the next two objectives mm-hmm. really are related. It's almost, I mean, a lot of people look at these almost as one huge objective, and it is a huge objective. Mm-hmm. We have install and administer Active Directory. Mm-hmm. Active Directory is everything. I mean, it really is. Without Active Directory,
you don't really have a usable network.
We have a peer-to-peer network.
Yeah, you don't have a usable network.
No more than 10 computers, right?
Yeah.
So Active Directory is kind of, it's the heart of everything. It's mm-hmm. what allows us, everything else we've been talking about, users and groups mm-hmm. and permissions and allowing things to interact with each other. It's all about Active Directory. So
this is your directory service.
Yeah, you need to know about installing domain controllers.
You think that's part of the test?
Yeah, maybe just a
little
bit.
Installing, yes.
Yeah, so you want to be able to fully understand all the different ways of installing your domain controllers.
So Ed, what happened to DC Promo?
What about it? I still use it.
Yeah. Why do they say DC Promo is gone?
Well, because it essentially is gone in the sense that what do we use now? I've already mentioned it. The new server manager.
Starts with the letter S.
Yes. That new server manager is where you're going to implement everything. Active mm-hmm. Directory is a role. Mm-hmm. And really, to be more specific, Active Directory domain services is a role. Because there are other Active Directory services, which we're not going to get into in this particular session.
Nope.
But in some of the other exams, we will talk about some of the other Active Directory services. Mm-hmm. But the Active Directory domain services is a role. Mm-hmm. You do install it through the server manager. Mm-hmm. Once you have it installed, well, and actually even beyond that, we also have things like IFM installed mm-hmm. from media,
yes.
right? So you want to make sure you understand that. And I can tell you, There are a lot of new advancements and really exciting ones for anybody who has worked with Active Directory, anybody who has installed Active Directory. Some new enhancements which really
Recycle
make it
bin.
Work now. Oh, well, didn't that exist in 2008 R2?
I'm excited about little things. The fact that I can use Recycle Bin and GUI. It's like, ooh.
Yeah, so, and if you're not familiar with it, and I will tell you, it is a little beyond the scope of this particular exam. But it could come up, like again, in the context of a question, the Recycle Bin, it's just what it sounds like. We're all familiar with the Recycle Bin in the operating system. It's where when we delete things, they go there, right? That way we can bring them back if it was an accidental delete. We can do that in Active Directory now as well.
Yes. And it is, we don't lose the SID anymore when we accidentally.
Yeah. And here's the thing. The Recycle Bin was always there.
Mm-hmm. Just couldn't really.
And when I say always there, since Windows Server 2008 R2. So
right.
It was always there since one
generation last version
ago.
Yeah.
But the difference was that we didn't have a good GUI interface to install it and make it functional.
To retrieve.
And now we do.
Yeah, to retrieve. Yeah.
So that's really kind of cool. Yeah. You want to make sure that you have the complete ability to manage your, really create and manage your users and your computer accounts and your group accounts and your organizational units. I mean, there's so many objects in Active Directory, and you need to make sure that you know how to work with all of them.
Right.
And how about that?
And go back to the basics again, understanding groups, things like group scope, group type. Well, understanding the difference between group type and group scope, what is it? And understanding things like a global catalog server, what exactly is it? What kind of a special domain controller it is, and what kind of special information it keeps compared to a regular domain controller?
Well, global catalog, isn't that just the yellow pages? I mean, that's what the icon looks
yeah,
like.
Yeah, it's a checkbox.
Yeah, it's a checkbox.
Yeah,
I know how to
is.
Install a global catalog server.
Yeah.
Yeah, no, definitely. You know, when it comes to managing this stuff, again,
know your tools.
Yes, and there is a new tool. Again, it's not completely new. It's not the first time we've seen it, but we do have the Active Directory Administrative Center.
Yes.
I need to just stop
a mouthful.
Yeah.
You need water. That's what you need.
Okay. Well, here, I'll take a drink. I'll take a drink while you talk.
Yeah, that's right. So with the Active Directory, with Active Directory users and computers, that tool is not new. But again, for the purpose of the exam, understanding the tool is there, how to create additional accounts, how to create additional user account, computer account, group accounts, and understanding there are other tools available for creating maybe bulk accounts. That's also part of your.
Yeah. you just had to go there, didn't
yeah,
you?
Yeah, I had to go there. Just to make it more complicated. More
and just for the fun of it, let's see, CSVDE. And what's the other one?
LDIFD. Good old days.
I just like saying that. LDIFD.
Yeah.
Yeah, these are bulk import LDIFD. Tools that have been around for a long, long time.
Even before Active Directory, actually.
Yeah.
Those two tools have been available for Exchange servers. So.
Yep. So, but you are going to want to be familiar with them. They are still in place. Now, PowerShell does help. Mm-hmm. Eliminate the need for some of those bulk import tools.
Yes, but you need to know them. Know that they exist and know the difference between the two. Know when to use them. You don't actually have to use the tools for the exam. They won't tell you to, you know, go ahead and import 200 user accounts. But know that they are there. Know the tools are there.
Absolutely. And, you know, I'd also like to mention real quick, you mentioned about group scopes and types.
Yes.
And that's another one of those just kind of small tidbits that people get hung up on.
Yes.
Okay, so I just want to make sure that you understand that the group types, there's two of them, because this is something we can do quickly. The group types are that we have our security groups, which is what most people think of. And by the way, when I say most people, I mean except for Cynthia.
Yeah, I don't think of it that way.
Cynthia works so much with Exchange. That's the other
distribution
type of group.
Distribution groups all the way.
That's right. The distribution groups, you don't assign permissions to your distribution groups. You only use those for the distribution of mass emails.
Yeah.
Now, the group scopes are where you get into your domain locals, your globals, or what we're now actually calling the domain globals, right? And then our universals.
Universals.
Okay, so just so you do understand what those types and scopes are.
So
now if we move things along into the last of the six objectives, because like I said, it's almost kind of like a part two.
It's related.
It's related to Active Directory, and that is creating and managing group policy.
Oh, they're your favorite topic.
I love group policy.
GPOs, yes.
Yes, let me tell you, I don't get it. People see group policy and they run for the hills when it comes to learning it. When the very first time I ever learned group policy, I thought this was the most fun thing in all of Windows. I really, really did. So I hope I hope that everybody can get to where I'm at with it, because mm-hmm. I'm not afraid of it. And what's awesome about that is it's so powerful.
Yes.
I mean, I have had people approach me anywhere and everywhere saying, hey, and I'm going to actually take us back a little bit to Windows 2000, approaching me and saying, hey, Ed, you know, I have this environment set up and I want to be able to do such and such. Can I do that with group policy? And I can tell you that the answer is almost 100%
yes.
And that's what I love about group policy. Mm-hmm. Group policy
it's
allows
flexible.
Us to manage our environments.
Standardize
completely.
It. Yes. Yeah, it's
right. Yeah. And I'll tell you, there's another buzzword I like to throw out there when it comes to group policy, and that's control. Okay, people talk about group policy allows you to control the user's environment, mm-hmm. right? Because as IT administrators, we're all a bunch of control freaks. No.
You mean we're not?
Well, maybe a little, but I am.
Right.
So control as in not lock everything down and make it you can't get to stuff, but in some cases, it's put stuff right there in front of the user
yes.
that they're going to need to do their job.
Yes.
So in some cases, it's giving them access to something using group policy.
Yes.
So you're going to want to make sure that you have full understanding of group policy settings, mm-hmm. preferences, which, by the way, that is a difference now. We have our policies and then also mm-hmm. preferences. And that relates to what I was getting at when I was talking about how people would approach me and say, could you do that with group policy? And I say, yes. Back in Windows 2000, I said yes with confidence because I knew that if nothing else, we could write a script to do what they wanted.
And let the GPOs push it out.
Yeah, let the group policy just push out the login script or a startup script.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas now with preferences, a lot of those things we used to have to script, we can now do within mm-hmm. those preferences.
Yep.
All right, so we have that. You have to make sure that you oh, here's my favorite word. I'm trying to figure out what language it is, but it's LSDOU. And I say it just that fast, like a word, LSDOU.
LSDOU.
Like I'm speaking some language.
Mm-hmm.
That is some language that translated to English is that's the order of application and inheritance of your group policy objects. So basically, here's something people get tripped up on all the time, and you need to make sure that you're solid on this, and I mean rock solid.
Mm-hmm.
And that is, there will be a whole lineup of GPOs in place in an enterprise environment.
Mm-hmm.
And when a user logs onto a system, there's that whole LSDOU process where this GPO applies and this one and this one and this one. And when you have conflicts, mm-hmm. right? This GPO says turn something on, this GPO says turn something off.
Yeah.
Which one wins?
Mm-hmm.
How do we know? Well, by default, it's the order that the settings are being applied. And the last applied wins.
Yes.
That's right.
So knowing the order is really important.
Yeah, and I will tell you, there's something that I learned. This is by complete accident that I did this once in a classroom.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, by complete accident I did this, but I shared it with everybody ever since. So I want to share it with you here right now. And that is, I had a group of people who just completely were struggling on that whole in order of inheritance and application and knowing which one wins. So I literally made the entire classroom stand up, walk out the door, and line up. And then they each were given a sheet of paper randomly that either said turn on, turn off, or leave it alone.
Mm-hmm.
Which, by the way, not configured
not
is
configured.
The setting in group
mm-hmm.
policy that is leave it alone.
Mm-hmm.
And then I had them walk in the door one at a time, open up their piece of paper, and do whatever it said to the light switch. Now everybody finally was in the room and sat down, and I asked the room, ultimately, who had control over these lights? And every single person in the room knew that the answer was
the last
I
guy.
Did. Well, to be specific, it was me.
Dude.
I intentionally went to the back of the line because they were like a bunch of school kids all jockeying to be first in line. I said, I'll go to the back.
Yeah.
But I had control.
Yes.
Now, you also need to know the group policy exceptions,
mm-hmm.
which is where we break those rules, okay, where we can have things like
loopbacks.
Well, we have loopback,
mm-hmm.
we have enforced, we have block
filter.
Inheritance, we have filtering.
Yes.
You're starting to get why maybe people freak out a little bit because, maybe I simplified the one thing and then I turned around and said, but here's all these exceptions to that rule.
Yeah.
So you want to make sure that you are real solid on this.
Yes.
So.
And with GPOs, even before you get into the group policy object and look at the settings, for the purpose of exam 410, understand how to create group policy object, understand how the order they're being applied, understand how to create exceptions. So this is just talking about an object as a whole. We're not even looking at the individual settings on what you can do with GPOs yet. That's coming up later.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
In another exam.
Yeah, in another exam.
And speaking of exams, you know what? That was all six of our main objectives.
Mm-hmm.
So what I'd like to do now, mm-hmm. and let's see, who I think I'm going to challenge you.
Rats.
I'm going to throw a little challenge here at Cynthia.
Oh, and, I'm the only one here. Oh,
what
no.
I'd like to do is I'm going to take just a quick practice question here.
Okay.
And it's obviously just one practice question. It's not going to get you ready for the exam.
No.
But we kind of want to walk you through the thought process as we're figuring out the answer to this.
Let's dissect the questions and just see how to best approach it.
All right. So let's take a look at this question.
Okay.
You are the network administrator for your company. Your company's network has a single forest with three domains. All domain controllers in your forest run Windows Server 2012. You will be expanding the personnel in one of your domains by an additional 200 users. You have created a spreadsheet with the properties of these new user accounts, and you want to import the spreadsheet into Active Directory. What should you do?
Ask for a week to do this, and then do it in 5 minutes and take the rest of the week off.
Atta girl. So what do you think?
Okay, so there is our options. We have run CSVD, okay. Mm-hmm. And replam into replicate, export the spreadsheet to comma delimited text file, and again to replicate, replam in, export, and okay. So here we have four options, and you notice there is a pattern to this. There's a talk of replication. There's a talk of exporting or importing the actual account. So this gives us an idea. First of all, let's do some elimination. So on the replication side, our options are replamin and rsdiag. So we can right away hone in on, well, rsdiag doesn't quite fit the situation.
Actually, you know, I'm noticing that there's a typo here.
Oh. There's a typo where?
There is. There's literally identical A and D, if you want to call it that,
or
the identical.
Oh,
yeah.
I see. Okay.
So use your imagination here real quick.
Which one is which?
The bottom one, rep admin, should be rsdiag.
Oh, okay. All right. Then I'm eliminating the bottom two right off the bat.
See, everybody, you have to know I'm a jokester, and I like to mess
She's
with
She's trying to
Cynthia,
mess with me,
so,
yeah.
I'll leave that little typo there.
Paying attention to see if she's
okay.
It.
So go back to what do you think? So it's mm-hmm. either rep admin or rsdiag. What are we starting with first there?
I'm going for the rep admin.
All right. So
I'm eliminating two right off the bat. I don't even have to worry about all of the four. So I'm narrowed down to top two. And the option here is run CSVD to import or export the spreadsheet, and then use Active Directory users and computers to import. Well, I know that you can't use Active Directory users and computers to import files, so that's a definite wrong for that. But the first one isn't 100% there either, just because if you really want to get technical about this, the question says you created a spreadsheet.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm assuming if you're using the spreadsheet, you're probably using Excel, and it's probably saved as a XLS file. You can't really use CSVD to do anything with XLS files. So there's a small missing step, which is making sure that file is saved as a .csv file before you use the CSVD.
So you're telling me there's no correct answer? This is a trick question?
It could be for people who overthink this, and I really want to emphasize it, because I was one of those people that overthink some of these questions.
Mm-hmm.
So when you look at it, my original thought is, if I feel that I'm overthinking the question, to me, I'm picking the least wrong answer. Anything that's obviously glaringly wrong, that's not the right answer, eliminate it. So notice that I eliminated the bottom two already, and now I'm eliminating the second one because of that obvious wrong statement of using Active Directory users and computers to do this. That leaves me with one answer.
And that answer would be?
I'm going for A.
A.
That's my final
All right.
answer.
That's your final answer. Let's see if you're correct.
Do I win anything?
Hey, all right.
Sweet.
Yeah, and I'll tell you what, we decided to use a question like this as an example because there's a very good point that you just made there, which is technically, if you overthink it and you look at every meticulous detail, there was no correct answer.
Mm-hmm.
And I have been in the exam room and I have seen that. I've seen where there's no correct answer. You know, in my mind, there's no correct answer. And one way I know it was explained to me is choose, remember, you'll see it right on the exam. Sometimes it'll say, choose the best answer.
Yes.
Or like you said, the least wrong
the
answer.
The least wrong, yeah.
And so although technically if you start really overthinking it, which is what Cynthia was just demonstrating to you, then you're going to sit there going, there's no answer, I don't know what to do, do I have to guess?
Yeah.
And that's not a good place to be.
Yeah.
You want to go ahead and really make sure that you eliminate the obviously wrong answers.
Mm-hmm.
And then stop overthinking it. Yeah. The reality is the CSVDE is a utility for bulk import. Active Directory users and computers does not have an import option. You can't do that. So as much as I might be sitting there going, well, technically I had to, and actually real quick, if we can look at that question again real fast. The true correct answer would have been if it would have been spelled out, export the spreadsheet into a comma delimited text file, and then run CSVDE to import the accounts. So it's almost like
a combination of A and B.
That really would be the right answer. Yeah. But I'm telling you that this is the way, you know, you have to think of things. Because in the real world, everything's not perfect black and white either. Mm-hmm. And there has to be an understanding that you're just trying to, you know, figure out what is the right scenario with that question.
Yeah. And something else I want to highlight is looking at these questions, dissecting it, you notice that this question, the first portion of it, really is not relevant to the answer it's looking for. So it's very possible that when you go into the exam room, read the exam question, getting overwhelmed by how many words there are across the screen, but pay attention to the key questions. What are they asking for? Does it matter it has three domains? No. So pay attention to the keys.
All right, should we do one more question?
Try one more. I'm going to make you.
You're going to make me answer this
answer
one?
This question,
throw another one at her.
Okay, right, so the next
away.
One. Okay, next one. If you take a look at the slide here, here's our question. We'll do it with Ed. You're network administrator for your company. You have deployed Windows Server 2012 on all server computers and Windows 8 on your client computers of your company. There are certain applications that users access through remote desktop. You must ensure that the highest level of security applies when user attempt to connect using remote desktop. Which option should you select when configuring remote desktop? And you have four options.
Okay, well, let's see here. I have the option of just not allowing connections to this computer.
That's totally secure.
That is very secure. And that is what was asked. It flat out says, you must ensure the highest level of security applies when users attempt to connect using remote desktop. Well, that seems like it might be the right answer, but you know what? You never want to answer the question unless you've looked at all your choices.
Yes.
So let's see what else we have here. Allow connections from computers running any version of remote desktop. That doesn't sound very secure. It sounds very generic. Mm-hmm. Allow connections only from computers running remote desktop with network level authentication. Boy, I wish I knew what network level authentication was. And then allow users to connect remotely to this computer.
That doesn't say anything.
That sounds very generic. So here's the deal. Mm-hmm. When I look at this, here's what I see. Allow connections from computers running any version of remote desktop and allow users to connect remotely to this computer. Both of those, to me, are just very open, very generic. There's no security there.
Right.
So what that narrows it down to is either don't allow connections to this computer or allow connections from computer running remote desktop with network-level authentication. Mm-hmm. Now, NLA, I kind of said to myself, I mumbled to myself, boy, I really wish I knew what it was. I do know what it is. But I'm kind of trying to give you the idea and the mindset of where you might be when you're sitting the exam and you see a question. You might see that one term and you just, oh, I wonder what that is. I know maybe I've heard that, but I don't. What is that term?
Okay. What's worse is if you actually have not heard that term.
Well, that's really
that
what
just
I,
means
like,
you
did they make that up?
Yeah, did they make that up? Does it really exist? This is going back to when I emphasize you really need to know your terminologies to know that what they're throwing you in the answers, is it a real thing?
Yeah, yeah. So basically, what that leaves me with is I can either just not allow connections at all, or I can allow with this network level authentication. Well, here's the deal.
Pick one.
Here's the deal. If you truly go with the most secure, it's don't allow connections, okay? But you also have to be a little real here. Mm-hmm. It specifically says there's a condition here that certain applications must be used through remote desktop. So therefore, I can eliminate that one. I know that can't be the right answer. And I'm going to go with allow connections only from computers running remote desktop with network level authentication.
Is that your final answer?
That is my final answer.
All right.
And that is the correct answer.
I'll let you have
that. Yes.
Yeah.
I knew you couldn't stump
me. You didn't lose the bet.
That is something to really keep in mind is you have to use a certain level of deduction, and it can really help you out when you're sitting through the exam. Now, speaking of sitting through the exam and preparing these, some of these last minute things, before we wrap this thing up, let's talk about just a few kind of quick tips and tricks.
Yeah. And our exam taking styles are different too. So.
Oh yeah, no, that is something that I will tell you. Cynthia and I have actually compared notes, and we have both been at this for about the same amount of time, and we've taken about the same number of exams, but we have realized that our styles are not the same, and what we do is not identical. And the key is take some tips from me, take some tips from Cynthia, take
see
tips from anybody that's out there. Figure out what works for you. That's what's most important. So let's talk about a few of these tips real quick, see if we can't help them out. So, you know, if we start off with right, you know, before you actually go to the exam, there's a very important thing here, and that is, remember I said taking the exam seems like an obvious, but it's not necessarily so obvious? You want to set a date. This is important. Setting goals is always important. So you're going to not just say, eh, I'm going to take that test
whenever I'm
ready. Sometime in the near future.
It is never going to be that day.
Set a date. Actually,
a date.
Schedule the exam so you have a goal and you say, you know what, I have to be ready by then. Okay, so along with goals, we have set small goals, right? Don't try to learn everything at once. And I'll tell you, that's me. I'm of that style. I kind of have to know all of it, or I feel like I know none of it.
You mean I don't learn it the night before?
Why not? You don't? No, you want to definitely make sure that you set smaller pieces. You know, we just set the six main objectives.
Yeah, the objectives.
Maybe learn one at a time and make sure you're solid on it.
Yeah.
That is something that, again, I struggle with a little bit. I kind of want to know all of it, or I feel like I don't know any of it. You'll never know any of it if you live strictly in that world.
Yeah.
Another tip is, and this would be right before you go for the exam, get a good night's sleep.
Right.
If you're not ready by the night before, you're probably not ready the next day either.
Nope. Sleep-deprived brain in an exam room when you're just stressing out, not a good thing.
Right, right. I mean, in fact, I'm going to add to that. We didn't have it on our slide, but you know, you should also make sure that you eat a good meal. Make sure you're hydrated, okay? So well-nourished, hydrated, rested. I mean, these are things that scientifically it's proven make the brain actually function better, and it's going to help you out. Now, if we talk about actually during the exam, now that we're in there, we've been kind of giving you these tips and tricks throughout this entire session as far as when we say, you know, pay attention to some of these. Don't overthink things and and pay attention
to
different
keywords.
Details. Look at keywords, terminology. But we also have some additional things here. And I love the very first bullet point we have here. And that is, don't panic. I cannot emphasize that enough.
And know where your towel is.
Do not panic.
Never mind.
I have actually had people have full-on panic attacks. I used to work at a training center that was also a test center, and we had full-on panic attacks. And you know what?
Breathe.
There's nothing to panic about. And I've had to go settle some people down and ask them point blank, why are you here? Why are you taking the test? What does this mean to you? Because here's the reality. If you fail the test, you know what it means?
You
means you have to take
it
again. That's it.
What's the worst that could happen?
You know, you have to take it again.
Yeah, take it again.
And right now, as I'm saying this to you, I don't know necessarily right now while you're watching it, but there is a second chance offer that's going on right now where you don't even have to pay for that second try if you go, if you fail the first one. So don't panic. Allow yourself to be relaxed. Don't stress out over things. Make sure you keep an eye on the time. Now, for the most part,
that's a big
time, see, time is usually okay, and I'm going to let Cynthia talk to this because I just learned this.
And, very different.
Cynthia, I take the test in half the time needed.
Yes, and in most cases, you have plenty of time for these exams. You're looking at about 50 questions, roughly, about 2.5 hours to do them. So if you break it down, even if each question takes the same amount of time, you have lots of time for those questions. However, if you're like me, I'm actually ESL. I'm a, you know, English as a second language. So I read slowly, and on top of it, I'm dyslexic. So if I don't pay attention and I start reading the question, I start skipping words. And a word like not is fairly important, and you don't want to skip that. It completely changes the answer to your question. So you want to read slowly, and you want to make sure you still give yourself enough time for this. My trick has always been, I always go through the entire exam and pick out questions, just read all of them. If a question I know exactly what the answer is, I select it, move on. Don't spend too much time on it. If you start noticing that you're rereading questions, your brain is just not clicking on what it's asking for, skip it. If you need to mark the question, go ahead and mark the question. Or you understand a question perfectly well, you're not understanding the answers. The options are too similar to each other, and you can't figure out which is which. Go with your gut instincts. Pick the one that you think is most likely the question, most likely the answer. Move on. Mark that question and move on. And this is where our style is different. Mm-hmm. As we're talking, I like to answer something before I move on to the next one, just in case if I should run out of time at the end of it, I don't leave any questions blank, because a blank question is complete zero loss points.
Right.
You don't even have any options of.
That's an important
anything.
Point to mention, mm-hmm. is that you want to answer all the questions.
Yes, you don't want to leave anything
an
blank.
An unanswered question is wrong.
Yeah.
An answered question could also be wrong, but it could also be right.
Yeah.
And with many of these questions, if let's say it's multiple choice and there's mm-hmm. four choices, well, then
you have 25% chance of getting it right.
Yeah. 1 in 4 chance of getting it right, mm-hmm. just by guessing. So make sure you answer them all.
Yeah.
Yeah, no, and I will tell you that there is, Cynthia and I differ in our styles when we're going through the exam as far as answering. She'll answer them even though she's marking it to come back and look at it again later, mm-hmm. whereas I will skip it if I don't know it, because I don't want to second guess and talk myself out of the answer later on. But we both agree on
the process of
changing your answers.
Yeah.
Once you've answered it,
don't change
your answer unless there's something compelling. Mm-hmm. Like maybe you saw another question that revealed some information or suddenly made a light bulb go off and you go, oh, wait, I answered that one wrong.
Yeah.
So.
And this is why going through the entire exam in the first pass is really important, because some of the questions will have exhibits. It gives you little pictures to see what the dialog box looks like. Therefore, it'll jot your memory about the questions.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
So that brings us pretty much to the end of this session.
Mm-hmm.
I'd like to throw up some resources that you can use to go ahead and continue your preparation.
Right.
Okay. We have the Microsoft Virtual Academy.
Mm-hmm.
Matter of fact, the middle thing we have there, that YouTube user cert training. That's the jump start. That's where you'll find the jump starts we talked about earlier.
Mm-hmm.
And then of course this big long URL, and I'm going to simplify this for you. The very bottom one. This is the specific URL to get to the information on the 410 exam specifically,
mm-hmm.
but you can actually just go, if you just remember Microsoft.com/learning, it's a whole new redesigned website, and it's very easy. Just click on certification and then pick the exam, and you're good to go.
It's a good place to check, because any kind of objective changes, number of questions, there's where it's updated.
Yep.
Get to find out.
So that's pretty much it.
You should
be ready for the 410 exam. So I wish everybody all the luck in the world, but you won't need it because you'll be prepared.
Yes.
And we look forward to seeing you in a future exam prep session.
Yeah.